Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is Wallenstein back with more Rome 2 Total War Pontus campaign. And now I realize I forgot to even talk in brief at all about the catapults I was talking about because I got distracted, or the catapults, the chariots. I don't know why I think catapults. Chariots that I had briefly mentioned in the last episode. I got distracted by, I think, one of my armies here that had some mercenary units that I wanted to get rid of. So, as I had said in the last episode, I don't like using them for two reasons. I don't think they're that good in the, of a unit in the game. I think that shock cavalry. That was weird. What happened there? Oh my god. I did not realize that. I did not realize you could do that. Okay, before I get distracted again. I don't think they're that good of a unit in the game. I think spear cavalry and melee cavalry, particularly shock cavalry, are much more effective just because they're much more maneuverable as they are in real life. The other is because historically, at this point in history, they kind of became obsolete. You still had factions that used them, like the Pont, like some of the Mithridatic kings of Pontus, like the some of the Egyptian pharaohs did when they rode into battle, and like the Iceni did at this point. Now there's a difference between how some of these factions use them, and what we believe to have happened traditionally is that they were the first form of horseback riding, if you can call it true horseback riding. That, as we understand, was found. I don't think I can do anything else here. I'm not going to forget. Don't worry. Excuse me. Let me just double check. They were one of the earliest forms of horseback riding, believed to be one of the first. So under our turn, and really in its earliest point of history, some historians believe that, especially among certain civilizations, they were used more as battle taxis. Now, by that I mean it in its almost literal sense. The chariots on the back of the horses would have two to three units, whether they be spearmen, swordsmen, archers, slingers, peltasts. They would be on the back of these chariots and be driven to a particular part of the battle where they would be urgently needed. So they were a very, very quick way of deploying troops and flanking maneuvers by certain factions. The Iceni, I believe, according to what historians understand it to be and what I've read, the Iceni used chariots specifically, I believe, for this purpose. It's very rarely, were they used in a full frontal charge, as some Hollywood adaptations of this time period would lead you to believe, similar to how I think the movie Gladiator kind of showcased this. Chariots were not used in full frontal assaults. Yes, they had, I know in Gladiator they had the scythe blades that were on the wheels. Yes, there were some chariots that did have these. It was more for a scare tactic and just to defend itself in case enemies tried, and I guess in case foot soldiers or other enemies tried to get close to the chariots as they were approaching. But they really didn't do any frontal assaults, and really wasn't meant to have a Rohirrim type charge like you would think might happen. And the reasoning behind that is because, think of it this way. Suspension hasn't been invented yet. as in the suspension of wheels, for riding. So you're driving, you're a charioteer on a chariot. You have no suspension, it's all wood, it's a spoke, a wheel, and a base that you're standing on. You're riding forward with your two horses, or however many horses are used for that. So I really can't, can I? Crap. That stinks. I'm just kind of talking to myself. Let's do that. Where was I? So you're going forward against the massive units. You really don't want to be charging forward towards those units. For the reason, because like I said, there's no suspension. So imagine this, like I said, imagine you're a charioteer. You have however many horses are pulling your chariot, and you're on this wooden frame with a wooden wheel and wooden spokes. If you were to run over a body, alive, dead, doesn't matter, or any kind of adverse terrain, whether it be rocks, hills, you're going to feel it. You will definitely feel it. Imagine driving your car at, let's say, 30, 35 miles an hour, just for theory's sake. I think that's roughly, maybe a little bit faster than how fast horses can go. But just to say 35, that sounds reasonable for me anyway. Excuse me. So you're riding along, and you come across a speed bump at 35 miles an hour, and your car has no suspension whatsoever. You go over that speed bump at 35 miles an hour, you're going to feel it. And you know, maybe in a car, it might not be as bad. You might just have a brief level of discomfort because you'll be lodged from your seat. And if you're tall like I am, you'll probably hit your head on the ceiling of the car, provided it's not a convertible. Sorry, and you will feel it. Now imagine being a charioteer with no cover, so it is like a convertible, but your only grip on the platform you're on is, for the most part, the reins of the horses. Now, you run over a dead body, like I said, dead body, or anybody, rocks, whatever, you might lose your footing, and fall off the chariot. You might lose the grip of the reins of the horse, and then lose control of the chariot while still being on the chariot. Or you might just, in most cases, probably damage the chariot by damaging either the wheels or the spools that hold the chariot, that keep the wheels spinning. So that's really the reasoning why chariots really became, once horseback riding was invented, once people started learning how to ride on horseback, chariots kind of waned in their popularity. Like I said, they were still used by some factions. Most were in more ceremonial roles, like the Romans did when they would parade into Rome after a victory against an opponent and against another army. That's odd. You use attrition there? Mountains, that's why. So you would have most factions still use them in ceremonial roles. Okay, for kings and emperors that are parading through the city. Some still use them in battle. Like I said, Pontus, the Mithridatic emperor, kings still use them, I believe. Egypt still use them. Egypt still used them for obvious reasons, because in the desert it's pretty flat and even. There's not a lot of hills or rocks or mountains, so they're pretty maneuverable there. And I don't know if the Seleucids used them at all. I don't think they did, at least at this point in history. And I don't even think they're usable in this game. I don't think the Seleucids have that as a I'm just thinking what I want to build here. I don't think the Seleucids use them. And like I said, the Iceni, they're kind of the big three, at least talking about, you know, in the context of this game, that use them in actual battle. But like I said, most of the time they were going to be used as battle taxis, specifically by the Iceni, from our understandings and from the readings of historical sources at the time, at that time period. So they've really kind of, especially after Rome conquered most of the Eastern factions, when they conquered Pontus, when they conquered Egypt, and when they took out the Iceni, chariots kind of really lost all battle purpose, really only being used as ceremonial units. So that's basically one of the main reasons why I don't like using chariots, despite the fact that this is a video game. You know, I really don't need to be playing it to be historically based, but I like that. I like to be at least somewhat historically based. Plus, I don't like them in this game anyway. I think, like I said, they're not very maneuverable. That's the other thing about them, that they can easily be... Where's my navy? If you're on foot, you can actually pretty easily avoid them, because they can't... Their steering is not very good. They're not as maneuverable as a regular horseman on horseback. I think Gladiator shows this too, how easy they are kind of just to bypass. You kind of just walk as the group of chariots will be huddled, you know, or amassing towards you. There'd be gaps in between each chariot, and basically as a skirmisher or any other unit, the units would kind of just aim for those gaps, go through them, and they would pass unhindered, unharmed, for the most part. So they really weren't quite... because of that reason and for many others that I've mentioned before, they really weren't quite that useful. So, there's the little history lesson for this episode. I blabbled on for about 10 minutes without really doing anything. Okay, let's just double check all of our places here. Ephesus will be a fully grown city in a couple of turns. We're looking pretty good, I think. Two armies will be coming into the border of Dacia very soon. I think we'll end our turn. Really not much else we can do. Maybe upgrade that. We'll upgrade Sinop to a level 3 timber town, and we'll think we'll be good. Excuse me. I'm still getting over the last stages of this cold. And my Thanksgiving break, well-needed Thanksgiving break is coming to a close. I took off today. Today is Monday when this video came out. I don't know that that really matters, but it was a nice, five-day weekend. No, I don't think so, Gnosis. Blah, blah, blah. Alexander is exposed. Blah, blah, blah. Excellent, my man. You're earning your keep, Alexander. Much like your forebearer's name. Couple of turns before I think I'm ready. You know what? I want to pull these guys back to help defend Olbia in case everything goes awry. Be Dini are moving in to take Gallic. That may be able to distract the Getae long enough in the next turn for me to move in. I probably think I can unfortify. Move my Cyclops Slayers into support. I think we should be good to go. I think next turn, I think we'll declare war and take them out. Let me just double check, make sure they're not allied with anyone I'm going to regret. Oh, they're at war with the Bowie too, so they definitely forced themselves into a pickle. They don't think that yet, they don't know that yet, but it's coming. Very soon. Anything else I can upgrade? Maybe Ankara. Yeah, maybe I'll do that. Upgrade Ankara to level 3 town. I think we should be good. He's already moved. Take my spy. So wow, they actually have a nice little trade hub. I shouldn't say that. Arakozy is actually was owned by the Arakozians, I think, in the beginning of the game. That's a nice little kind of isolated area here. I mean, you're in perfect striking distance to what I'm thinking is a small, unwalled port town. It's a shame we can't place these guys. I wonder what these would be considered. I know in this game they're considered eastern, but I'm wondering if it would be a stretch of the imagination to consider them maybe Indian? Maybe it's a stretch. Maybe more maybe Persian. Anyway, that's enough musing. How are we looking here? Very nice. Very nice indeed. Upgrade that. And I think we'll end our turn. Oh! Shit, I forgot two things. I forgot to move my navy. Ah, and I forgot to move my army in the mountains. Crap. Oh well. Alright, once this turns up, we shall go to war. Well, I want to see how quickly, I don't know how many, Teresa, yes. The Etruscan League, Sagartia. Bam. That's a great name of a city. Bomb, I'm sure it's pronounced Bomb. So where's the Etruscan League at? Aha, I thought so. And they're allied with Rome. Are they a satrap? No, they're not. Wow. Turn of events for the Etruscan League. Friendly with the Romans and pissed off at war with the Carthaginians.
We will gladly listen to your offers, but do not wrap them in lies. Their spirits know truth.
Yeah, whatever. It'll get me friendly, even more friendly with Rome. I don't want to get dragged in just yet. Where's my navy? Alright. We're looking pretty good, I think. Pretty square. Pretty fair for squares. Yeah. let's move north here, see what we got. Nobody there. It'll be enough to distract them. Can I move? I can take it if I want to. I'll wait one more turn, I think. I'll wait for my Champions of Amasis to support my main unit. And then I think I'll move in. Okay. I think we're pretty good to go. Pretty good to go, I think. No more growth there, unfortunately. Ephesus will be a fully grown city in one more turn. We're looking good in the neighborhood here. Upgrade my leather shop. Let's upgrade all of our unique unit guys here. Winemaker, I think that should be good. No, we got one more. And now I think that should be good. Yep. That'll drastically decrease my food supplies. But once I conquer these station areas, I'll start turning these into some farm places as well. I can't turn that down. We will end our turn. And then we will move to take the Dacians. Their days are numbered. So once we deal with the Dacians, that leaves it, opens up new opportunities against the Celtic and Germanic factions.
Glory, wealth.
Of course, I say this because I'm hoping that the East doesn't backstab me. I don't think they will. Okay, I think, yes, we're moving in.
My lord. The Lord, my lord. By sea or by mountain, sire.
I can't take it in one turn. Excellent. Oh wow, they have actually moved up and taken out a lot of the Bowie. Good, 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 good. Nah, don't want to call my allies in to help. Macedonians will definitely help. Why not?
Ah, war, good. Sword, will escape.
Take the capital.
By sea or by mountain, to the pillars of Heracles, if you wish. Ready? We take this settlement for you, my lord.
Take this bad boy. And then the next turn, we might be able to take the walled city as well. So Dacians got a little bit more than they could bargain for, I think. So we'll take the Dacian province very nicely, I think. We've expanded our borders a little bit further. We will start immediately Hellenizing these areas. Even though it might cost us a bit. Is that Petrodava? I love it how it still has that Russian name attached to it. Yeah, let's do a farming settlement. Doing pretty well. Alright, now if I can sabotage these guys, prevent them from moving. No. But you increased in rank. Okay. Fine with me. Maybe I should have sent him over here, although I don't think there's any armies over there. I think they're all heading up north here. We'll take the Dacian province probably in the next turn. Excellent. All with minimum casualties. Do that. I'm assuming the Dacian and Illyrian factions count, and Thracian factions count as barbarians. I'm not sure how they. I'm assuming that's how they're counted. If not, I don't know. I don't know how. Okay. Oh. Yes, almost forgot. All right, we'll end our turn. See how the Getae respond. If they respond. And see what the Boii do too. I'm hoping they don't move in and take that walled city. I'll be pissed. So they're falling back, okay.
The greatest dare speak of peace to their enemies. Only the weak seek the death.
Getae lost their northernmost province.
A treaty would be an arrow shot with deadly intent against our mutual enemies.
Sure. In case I do go to war against them at some point. Thank you. Don't mind if I do. Heracles. I have done all you asked. Yeah, I think we'll go with these guys.
To the pillars of Heracles, if you wish. At once.
Our research is complete. Rome looks like they lost another province of theirs, no surprise. supply reforms. So let's complete our supply reforms. Since we did our siege thing here. So I think we're doing pretty nicely. We've moved open another province. We can probably... Excuse me. Probably start pacifying this area. You know what? I might make this a military base as well. I think that's what I might do. I think that's what I'll do. I'll change these into consecrated grounds. Malva. Looking pretty good there. I will remove that bonus and install upon these guys. Yeah, there is no Britain games. Slowly Hellenize these areas. Okay.
We fight for you, my lord.
After losing that territory, so let's see what we got now. This might be a record for me too, and how many territories I have had in a playthrough. So we can move. Probably take out, maybe take out the rest of the Getae. The Getones looks like they're pretty friendly. Not very friendly with the Boii though. So we're pushing into the barbaric north, probably, as of right now, further than any... Well, I shouldn't say further. Trajan conquered this area, but very... in the next 100 years lost it, I think. My dates are correct. So I think we're pretty good. We'll end our turn. Who are we not assigning skills to here? These guys? Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah, let's do that. Let's do that. Oh, before I forget. I keep forgetting I have other units in this area, and I have my freaking champion, I think, that I've kept forgetting time and time again. Spy. Where's my spy?
My lord, as you command, my lord. In Apollo's footsteps.
Send them to discover these two towns. Shouldn't be missing anything else. We'll discover Arabia Felix and the Arabian Peninsula, see what's going on there. We're slowly uncovering the Germanic north. And seeing who has survived here. The Boii look like they've defended themselves pretty nicely against the Suebi. I don't even know if the Suebi are still alive. It looks like the Boii have their main territory, their starting territory. Well, we will find out. Especially now that we have a spy in this area. And, ooh, what do we have here? The Boii are moving their armies in. And if I recall... No, they're not at war. They're just at war with the Nervii, the Getae, and the slaves. Okay, so I think that's a good spot to leave it again for now. I hope you enjoyed the little history lesson in the beginning. Hope I didn't talk you guys' ears off. I hope you guys are still watching it after that. So we will leave it there for now. We very swiftly took the Dacian province. We took the Getae by surprise, I think. I definitely made a good call in not having them as my satrap earlier in the game, if I remember. So we've added another province to our domain. We're slowly creeping up. Let's see, how many more do I need, actually? One more territory, it looks like, before we're at Imperium level 5. Okay, that's nice. So yeah, I think we'll leave it there for now. Nothing on the Civil War meter. So we're doing pretty nicely, I think. I don't know when this game ends. I don't know if it's maybe the year 100 BC. Or not. I will find out. This will probably be the first time I've ever actually gone fully through time-wise and completed a game. So we will see. Thanks all for watching, and comments below as always. And I will see you all next time.